Jesus Christ said, unless you believe that I am He, the Messiah, that you shall die in your sin. Nobody knows what that's like. It's in the land of the living. All the people who have died in their sin are in hell. If they were here to tell you what hell is like, it's not a reason we should repent. But the reality and the horror of hell should be enough to turn people away from sinning and seek God. But likewise, you know, if you see what heaven is like, how beautiful, how amazing heaven is, the same way you'd want to go there. You know, you'd want to be in heaven if you actually seen what it was like. But the thing is that God reserves heaven for people who love Him, who seek after Him, who struggle and repent and hate sin and condemn sin and wickedness. Each and every one of us falls short of the glory of God. And so many of us are an ongoing work, you see. But to understand who Jesus Christ is the most important thing. Not only is He just the Messiah and the Son of the living God, but He's the High Priest who intercedes for your sin. He's the King of Kings who has complete authority over what happens on the earth. Complete authority. He even said to Pilate that unless it was given to you, your authority from the Father, you can do nothing. Hallelujah. Nobody can do nothing without the... Not even a bird falls from the sky without God knowing it. Before even God brought this world into existence, He saw everything from beginning to end. He saw all the people that mock Him. He saw all the people that died in the flood of Noah. He saw the sin in Eden. He saw the Christian church, many of the hypocrites in that, and many of the people that stand up and preach the word of God. Hallelujah. How you doing? And he sees all the religions, and He makes sure that His Son is seen by every one of these religious men, whether they have the Vedas as a reference to Him, Yisha, Misha in them, whether you have a Quran as a reference to Yeshua, Jesus Christ in there, the Son of God, born of a virgin, sinless. All these things are to make you understand you need Jesus to enter into the kingdom of God. There's no use saying that you follow a man and he's a prophet, but you don't listen to what he says. You know, going to church doesn't make you a Christian, just like going into McDonald's doesn't make you a Happy Meal. You know? And so God knows our hearts. I've heard many Christians say that, God knows my heart. Does that not scare you? God knows all your secret sins and the things that are going through your head every day. Does that not scare you? Because Jesus said He came to make His new creatures, as it says in the epistles. New creatures in Christ. We must be gutted out, you know, and rebuilt into the image of God again. Because we're all fallen. And it's done from the inside. That your spirit and your soul is the most important thing. Your body's going to go back to the dust where it was created. So what about your spirit? What about the soul inside of you? Where is that going to go? You think you can get into heaven through your good works? In the Bible it says your works are like rags before God. Now good works pleases God. And you can do a lot of good works through faith in Jesus Christ. Good works include charity. Mentions charity dozens of times in the Bible. These things please God. But even through your best works, you're still not going to get in. It's through faith in Jesus Christ the Lord, who He is and what He did for you on the cross at Calvary. Hallelujah. He is our covering. He is everything. He is all in all. And He didn't command His people to dress up in fancy robes and dresses and say that they're the church. Not at all. Look at the apostles. They were just fishermen. They were uneducated men. Jesus chose these men to represent Him. Not religious Pharisees. He chose working men and women to represent him and to preach his word, the good news of the gospel, that he died for your sin and rose again on the third day, and he's calling you into a relationship with him, that you come to him with a humble and repentant heart, kneel before him, ask him into your life to be your Lord and Savior. And if you're sincere about it, he will come into your life and he will give you a thirst after his word, a thirst after righteousness. He will transform your heart and mind from the things that you're seeking just now, the temporary things, the perishable things. Quite foolish to, if you think about it, if you're seeking things of the world which are going to perish anyway, it is pretty foolish. But you don't know that. You don't know that there's an eternal God in heaven. It's not your fault, really. But have you ever considered it? Have you ever listened to the gospel? Have you ever cracked open a King James Bible to read about who Jesus is for yourself? And what is your objections today? The Bible says today is the day of salvation. What's your objections of coming before God today? Examine your heart and mind. Why don't you want to be in the presence of God? Why don't you want to follow after the things of God? Why not? The things of God is truth and righteousness and eternal life. The things of God are good. Hallelujah. Things of this world are perishable. Hallelujah. See, the first epistle of John says, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled the word of life. For the life is manifest, and we have seen it, and bear witness, and show unto you the eternal life which was with the Father, and was manifest to us. That which we have seen, and declare we unto you, that you also may have fellowship with us. Truly our fellowship is with the Father, and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And these things write we unto you, that your joy may be full. That then is the message which we have heard of him, and declare unto you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. You can see the brightness of the sun today. The sun is out today. But it describes when people see Jesus Christ is 7 times brighter than the sun. So you can see that this, it's very hard to look at the sun. But Jesus Christ in his heavenly glory is 7 times brighter than the sun. It says if we walk in the light as he is light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ his Son cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. So God is just looking for a bit of honesty here. That's all he's looking for. He does the rest. He forgives us and he anoints us to do his work. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar and his word is not in us. So I've met a lot of Christians that don't like admitting that they're sinners, that they're still sinning even though they're saved. They have a fleshly problem. A lot of Christians say, oh no, I don't sin. The word of God to you says, we see that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. So we must come to God with humility, acknowledging our sin before him, and making sure that we choose a righteous path. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Only through Jesus Christ alone. My little children, these things write I unto you, that you sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus the righteous. Let me read that again. My little children, you're referred to as a child because God is eternal. You've only been here a few decades. You don't know anything, hardly. As many of you think you know everything, but you hardly know anything compared to God. Little children, these things write I unto you, that you sin not. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. So a righteous person intercedes for his family, for his people, just as Daniel interceded for Israel. He don't stand there and condemn them to hell. Just as Moses interceded for Israel again coming out of Egypt. A righteous man or a high priest intercedes. When you repent, Jesus hears that. He's the Word of God in heaven, and he sends forgiveness to you. If you have any sin problems, any guilt problems, and you're projecting that onto other people. Hallelujah. A lot of us do that. We don't know about God's forgiveness, God's mercy, and we project our problems, project our guilt onto other people, blame other people for our sin. That's narcissism. It's a form of narcissism. Be humble, repent, and then it means that you're able to uplift your family, your friends. You know, you're not going to project your own insecurities onto them. It's narcissism. And he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. What he's saying there, not just for the sins of Israel, but for all the nations, all the entire earth, those who seek after Jesus Christ. He is the propitiation for our sin, atonement. Hereby we know that we know him if we keep his commandments. Many Christians say, I don't keep God's commandments, they're gone away. That's not what the Bible says. Not what the Bible says at all. Hereby we know that we know him if we keep his commandments. That's how you know if you're following Jesus Christ or not. You see, if I know him and keep not his commandments, is a liar and the truth is not in him. Again, it's an ongoing battle. The first epistle of John is suggesting that sin in a Christian's life or in anyone's life should be a battle. Your battle is not against things of the flesh. Your weapons are not carnal, but the weapons of the kingdom of heaven are spiritual. Don't you understand that a lot of the things in the world that God puts there in order to keep you humble, and that he had to put a thorn in Paul's flesh in order to keep Paul seeking Jesus Christ? Keep seeking him every day. You have to put a thorn in Paul's flesh to do that. That's why life is very hard. But it's to make you hit your knees and seek Jesus Christ and realize that you have a sin problem. It's because of your sin that you keep going through the same trials and tests. All we need to do is confess our sin to him, and he's faithful to forgive us. Whoever keepeth his word, in him verily is love of God perfected. Hereby know that we are in him. He that saith he abide in him ought himself also so to walk, even as he walked, as Jesus Christ walked. So if you're saying you're a Christian, the righteous live by faith, we should walk the way Jesus Christ walked. That's a very, very high call order to do. But that's what the Bible says, if you're a Christian. Brethren, I write no new commandment unto you, but an old commandment which you had from the beginning. The old commandment, the word which you have heard from the beginning. These are the Ten Commandments he's speaking of. And it says, again, I write unto you which thing is true in him and in you, because the darkness is past and the true light now shines. He that saith he is in the light and hates his brother is in darkness even until now. So if you're saying you know Jesus, you know that God is light, and if you have any hatred in your heart towards any group of people, then it says that there's a bit of darkness in you, and you need to seek God, who is in complete light. God completely loves you in a more complete way than any human being can love you. God loves you that much. But he wants you to walk with him in that light. He that loves his brother abides in the light, and there is no occasion of stumbling in him. But he that hateth his brother is in darkness and walks in darkness and knows not whither he goes, because the darkness has blinded his eyes. I write to you, little children, because your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. So unless you know Jesus Christ, you're still going to die in your sin. Jesus said, unless you believe I am He, I am the Christ, you will die in your sin. I write unto you, fathers, because you have known Him as from the beginning. I write unto you, young men, because you have overcome the wicked one. I write unto you, little children, because you have known the Father. You know, Jesus said, you must become like a little child to enter into the kingdom of God. Children have a very simple faith, a simple belief. They don't have a complex religious system. They just have a simple belief and faith that there is a God, there is a Creator. That's the way we must be if we want to enter into God's kingdom. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that sin is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of this world. And the world passes away, the lust thereof, but he that does the will of God shall abide forever. Jesus said, unless you do the will of the Father, he will tell you, depart from me, you worker of iniquity, for I don't know you. So are you about the things of the Father, doing the will of God, as he came and gave us the Lord's Prayer, our Father who art in heaven, venerated his name, hallowed be your name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Is that your prayer as well? God's will be done? What is God's will? Little children, it is the last time, and as you have heard, the Antichrist shall come. Even now, there are many Antichrists, whereby we know that it is the last time, the last days. They went out from us, but they were not of us. If they had been of us, they would no doubt have continued with us. But they went out that they might be made manifest that they were not of us at all. These are Christians who depart from the faith. That's what that's talking about. So is it possible to lose your salvation? Yeah, the Bible says it's possible. But you have an unction from the Holy One, and you know all things. I have not written unto you because you know not the truth, but because you know it, and that no lie is of the truth. Who is a liar but he that denies that Jesus is the Christ? He is the Antichrist, denieth the Father and the Son. So many religions say that Jesus isn't really the Messiah, he's not really the Son of God. Really? You'll have to face Jesus one day. You'll have to actually face him and he'll judge you. As it says in your holy book, he's the judge of the earth. Jesus says, all power in heaven and earth shall be, has been given unto me, past tense, has been given unto me. And he will, future tense, judge the earth. Whosoever denies the Son, the same hath not the Father, but he that acknowledges the Son has the Father also. Let that therefore abide in you which you have heard from the beginning. If that which you have heard from the beginning shall remain in you, you also shall continue in the Son and in the Father. And this is the promise that he hath promised us, even eternal life. These things have I written unto you concerning them which seduce you. He's talking about spiritual seduction here. All of the blessings from everyone in the Bible, Abraham, Isaac, David, every single one mentioned in the Old Testament, including Ishmael and all of them, all the blessings came from the God of the Bible. Every single one of these people's blessings came from the God of the Bible. Got to understand that. But the anointing which you have received of him abideth in you, and need not any man teach you, but as the same anointing teaches you of all things, and is truth, and is no lie, and even as it has taught you, you shall abide in him. So it speaks of this in the book of Hebrews, it speaks of this in Jeremiah 31, 33. No man shall teach his neighbor, that God's command shall be written on the hearts and minds, and that is the new covenant. That's what the Bible teaches. How many of you keep God's commandments who are Christians? How many of you have a clue what God's commandments are? Can maybe name five of them, six of them? Should be actually written inside of you. Just as I know that Christians tattoo their body in the outside, some people do, and they actually write God's word on their flesh. No, the Bible says when you're born again, it's written in your heart and mind through the Holy Spirit. You see? Alright, God bless you. Let me continue to read this. And it says, and now, little children, abide in him, that when he shall appear, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. Read back again. Now, little children, abide in him, that when he shall appear, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. If you know that he is righteous, you know that everyone that does righteousness is born of him. Again, this is a fruit of your life. If you're saying you're following Jesus Christ, that you're doing the righteousness of God, you're interceding for people. Sometimes you pray for people and they get healed. Sometimes these people come to the Lord through that. Sometimes they don't. You just say, well, maybe it's a coincidence, or they just thank the person, and then they forget that God is the one who healed them. God is the one who deserves your thanks and praises. Jesus said, give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, give to God what belongs to God. Your soul, your very life, all your veneration, praise and worship belongs to him who sits upon the throne in heaven. Have faith in the Lord. Hallelujah. Keep having faith.
Yeah, we're almost shot.
You look better dressed than me, anyway.
Well, we need our best.
I look great
as well. I'm homeless. We don't need my tram to be homeless.
Absolutely not, no. So how are you doing, man?
What's your best in the Bible?
I'm reading out 1 John, isn't
it? John's smart. Good.
1 John 3 says, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore, the world knows us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we shall know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Thus saying the Bible, that when Jesus appears in his heavenly glory, seven times brighter than the sun, and the saints at their resurrection, when Jesus comes in the clouds, the saints will also look like Jesus Christ. He's seven times brighter than the sun. And it's going to happen at some point. It's called the rapture. It's going to happen at some point in history. Tom, how you doing? Chapter found in the Bible. Jude, the servant of Jesus Christ, the brother of James, to them that are sanctified by God the Father and preserved in Jesus Christ, and called. Mercy unto you and peace, and love be multiplied. Do you know the love of God?
Yeah.
Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write to you and exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered to the saints. There is only one faith according to the holy books. Only one faith. There's only one God, one Messiah. Question is, did he die for your sin? So many proofs of that. It takes faith to believe it, but there's a lot of proofs, a lot of eyewitnesses. It says, for there were certain men that crept in unawares, who were before of old ordained to the condemnation, ungodly men, turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness, and denying the only Lord God, our Lord Jesus Christ. I will therefore put you in remembrance, though you once knew this, how the Lord, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterwards destroyed them that believe not. So you can only please God with faith, and actually displeases God when you don't have any faith. There is only one faith, one God, one Messiah, according to the Quran and according to the Bible. And the Vedas as well. And the angels which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he hath reserved in everlasting chains under darkness to the day of judgment of the great day. It says, even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities about them, there's five cities of the plains which were destroyed because of their sin. It says, giving themselves over to fornication. Now that is basically seen as having relations outside of marriage. Okay. Some cities, they had relations with animals as well, according to the Bible, and that's what people are doing now. You go to some countries in the world and it's legal to sleep with a dog, a cat, all that stuff. Kind of like what was happening in the days of Noah. It says, likewise also these filthy dreamers defile the flesh, despise dominion, and speak evil of dignities. So even when there's someone doing good, someone helping people, somebody loving righteousness, they get condemned. You know, people don't like that. We're sort of coming into these days just now. You're getting a sort of a lot of anti-heroes in the movies as well. The heroes used to be like very clean-cut, sort of clean-shaved people and all that. Now the heroes in the movies have the arms chopped off. They've got laser eyes, they've got these mad crazy weapons going around shooting at innocent people. That's like anti-heroes in the movies. It says, yet Michael the archangel, when contending with the devil, he disputed about the body of Moses, durst not bring against him a railing accusation, but said, the Lord rebuke thee. And so when you're in spiritual warfare, you keep it on a spiritual level. And that's what's happening today, is a lot of spiritual warfare, which might manifest into the physical at some point. The Bible does prophecy about a World War III as well, in Daniel 11. So you've got to be aware of that. If it happens, it's in the Bible. Three world wars and then Jesus Christ's second coming. But these speak evil of those things which they know not, but what they know naturally as brute beasts, in those things they corrupt themselves. Woe unto them, for they have gone the way of Cain, and ran greedily after the error of Balaam for reward, and perished in the gainsaying of Kor. These are spots in your feasts of charity, when they feast with you, feeding themselves without fear, clouds that are without water, carried with about of winds, trees whose fruit withers, twice dead, plucked up by the roots. Raging waves of the sea, foaming out their own shame, wandering stars, to whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. God will judge people, every work that you've done in your body. It says in the Bible, it says in the Quran, Jesus is the judge of the earth. It all refers to it in the Vedas as well, I believe, as well. So there will be a judgment. God will have a final judgment. And if you've accepted his sacrifice, which he gave on the cross at Calvary, you'll be asked to come into God's kingdom. Not because you yourself are righteous, but because you have repented. You have believed God for his propitiation, that he provided the Lamb in order to die for your sin to make you righteous. Jesus died to make you righteous, even though we don't deserve it. We don't deserve salvation. We don't deserve heaven. But that's why Jesus died. Okay? The blood of Jesus Christ is the reason that there's Christianity. And there's many, many thousands of witnesses that saw Jesus resurrected from the dead. It says to execute judgment upon all and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds which they have ungodly committed and of their hard speeches which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. That very verse is taken from the Book of Enoch. It says, these are murmurers, complainers, walking in their own lusts. Their mouths speak great swelling words, having men's person in admiration because of advantage. But beloved, remember ye the words which were spoken of the apostle of our Lord Jesus Christ. How that they told you there would be mockers in the last time who would walk after their own ungodly lusts. And so just as the days of Noah, Noah was told by God to build an ark, and he was mocked, continually laughed at, until it started seriously raining, and everybody wanted to come inside the ark. So it's just like that in the last days, when God begins to pour out his judgment upon the earth. Run to God, run to Jesus Christ. He's the only way you can get saved. He's the only one who's going to save you, the only one who died for you. Hallelujah. Run to Jesus Christ. These be they who separate themselves, sensual, having not the Spirit. But ye beloved, build up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. Remember that God is merciful. Remember that God is forgiving. I don't know what God idea of God you have in your head, but he's a God of judgment. He's also a God of mercy. He wants you in his kingdom. He doesn't want you burning in hell for eternity. That's not why he created you. He created you to serve him. He created you in order to enjoy him, enjoy his creation, to prosper according to his work. That's why you're here on this earth, to give God glory. But because of our sin, the original sin that's passed down through the generations, we have a sin problem. And the Bible says sin brings forth death, and when a person dies, then comes the judgment. God judges us all. It says, and of some have compassion, making a difference. Jesus said, if you have mercy, you shall obtain mercy. It's very important to have a heart like God, a character like God. Make sure if your friends or family sin against you, forgive them. Have mercy on them. Don't hold any grudges against them. That's what Jesus said. That's part of God's character. When we repent and we ask for forgiveness from God, God forgives us. And it's just the same, in the same way Jesus said, if you are merciful, you shall obtain mercy. So even though you might have a high standard of righteousness, I don't know if you do. I don't know many people, and you might have a high standard of morality, but we're not meant to judge one another according to our standards, because we'll be judged according to the Word of God, which is perfect. Jesus Christ lived a perfect, sinless, blemishless, spotless life and died on the cross. And according to even the Quran, it says that Jesus was spotless, blemishless, did miracles. There's two references at least, even in the Quran, that speaks about Jesus' death and resurrection. Many references in the New Testament about Jesus' death bringing the saints life. All you need to do is ask the Messiah to come into your life, ask Jesus to come into your life, ask for forgiveness, and he gives you a new heart and he gives you a new mind. The Apostle Paul said, I am a Pharisee of Pharisees. He knew the law very, very well. He thought he was keeping the commandments until he met Jesus, until he met God's perfection on the road to Damascus. And he was convicted about his sin, being a sinner. And he bowed down and he obeyed what Jesus told him because he was deaf. In fact, he was blind for several days, so he had no choice. It says, others saved with fear, pulling them out of the fire, painting even the garments spotted by the flesh. It says, now unto him that is able to keep you from falling or from sinning, and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. It's only that blood that Jesus shed that makes you holy. And Jesus said, be holy as I am holy. And we're meant to live holy lives if we're Christians. Very difficult. We're meant to be honest as well. You know, Jesus said, no hypocrite will enter into the kingdom of heaven. And so we must be very honest about the lives we're living. If we're Christians, if we're not Christians, seek God's mercy and forgiveness. Hallelujah. And it says, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen. So to God be the glory forever. Bible and all the prophets that spoke right throughout the ages, called as a lesson right up until the last days, and the nations start to rebel against God. The nations start to get rebellious and fight against one another, as Jesus said in Matthew 24. There'll be earthquakes in diverse places, wars and rumors of wars, famines, earthquakes. All these things are rising. If you see the graphs of these things, the earthquakes, you see the unrighteousness of the nation just matching these graphs as the nations get more and more rebellious, unrighteous. The book of Proverbs said, it's shame unto a nation. Unrighteousness is shame unto a nation, as it says in the book of Proverbs. But who's ashamed of unrighteousness these days? Anything goes. I believe in Canada, it's legal now to have sex with your dog. It's just legal. So, that's the days we're living in. You know, I've only been to Holland once. Even Holland scares me, but, you know, because of all the stuff that goes on there. But, being around, traveled around, and the world is just getting steadily more and more rebellious against God. They're just getting more sort of, grieve when it comes to rebelling, doing more and more and more sin. But the judgments are being poured out gradually. If you study Fukushima, you can see that the North Pacific is now almost dead, that the radiation is about 1,000 times more in parts of California than it was 10 years ago. I mean, it's a way past deadly levels of radiation. And so the judgments are just gradually being poured out. Cancer rate is going up all the time. People dying of AIDS, cancer, all kind of different things, just shooting up the roof. Death, famines, earthquakes, wars, rumors of wars. Jesus said this in Matthew 24. And I'll come to the point that the nations will just decide, well, I think we've kind of silenced most of the Christians now, and, you know, we can basically do what we want. So we'll turn against Israel. And that if you read Zechariah 14, it says that the nations gather together in the valley of Megiddo. I don't know how many of you have seen the movie called Megiddo or Megiddo. It was done about 10 or 15 years ago. You see all these end time movies about, you know, disaster movies, all that stuff, and it's all happening around the world, wherever you go. Tornado was another one that I saw. You see that the devastation that's caused by the earthquakes and tornadoes in America and in China and all that. So you're just getting the judgments being turned up. As people get more and more rebellious, God pours out more and more of his judgment. And it just so happens that there are righteous people that are suffering in this world as well. Look at the children that are suffering in this world. All the orphans suffering. Recently visited Ethiopia and Addis Ababa. And I walked through the streets there. And I seen just children, orphans just lining the streets. If you want to open an orphanage, go to Ethiopia. What they do is they go to the Haile Selassie Palace in the middle of Addis Ababa, thinking that they'll get fed. All the poor people go there, but Haile Selassie is no longer there. You know, he was dethroned in the back about the Second World War. So all they get is they have to get Christians going to feed these people. Without Christians, no one would get fed in these areas of the world. And so if you say that you're a Christian, this is Ethiopian Orthodox, this is born again Christians, you may have heard of them. And you know, Jesus said that a man must be born again to inherit the kingdom of heaven. Born of water first and of the Spirit, which speaks of baptism, water baptism, and spirit baptism. If you've not had these things before, you're not saved. You're still in rebellion before God, sadly. Even if you live quite a righteous life, the Bible says that your best works are like rags before God, because compared to God, he's perfect. It says even in the Word of God that no man has seen the Father. Only Jesus the Son can approach the Father, because no man is righteous enough to do it. It says in the book of Revelation, there's no being that was righteous enough to open the seals and to die on the cross for people's sin. Because everyone sinned. Even Elijah, even the greatest of the prophets sinned, according to many of the holy books. Nobody was found perfect except Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And this is why we need him. Not only the propitiation, the blood that was shed at the cross of Calvary, but when you repent and you ask Jesus into your life, what you get is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the presence of the living God. The very sustenance, the very person of the Holy Spirit referred to in the Bible. Yahweh the Father, Yahweh the Son, Yahweh the Holy Spirit, and these three are one, it says in the Gospel of John, 1 John 5:7. Hallelujah. So I hear many religions following false messiahs. Even the Quran mentions Jesus is the Messiah. There can only be one Messiah. It says in the Quran, Jesus is the Messiah. Hallelujah. Also says in the Vedas that the chief of the gods would send a part of himself to die for the sins of his people. This is why so many Hindus come to Jesus Christ. It's about 100 million Christians in India. It's about 1.2 billion people in India, and about 100 million of them are Christians. And there's about, what, 60 million people in the UK, and about, apparently in the last survey, they said 50% are Christians. Really? I wonder how many are born again. I wonder how many have given their life up for Jesus, read their Bible daily, have been water and spirit baptized. If that's you, if you know that you need to come to the Lord, if you've not been water baptized or spirit baptized, I'm here. I'm sure there's other churches that will help you in these areas. Okay? A lot of people have problems with God. They blame a lot of their problems on God. But the Bible teaches that there is a adversary of God who's called Satan the devil, who just basically fights against every human being alive. Satan wants to drag you into hell with him, because God's already condemned the devil. He's already told the devil you're going to hell for eternity. And so the devil doesn't like to be reminded of that. Sometimes you can just remind them of that. They're having a bad day. Remind the devil that he's going to hell. But Jesus wants to take you to heaven with him. And Jesus wants to give you eternal life. And there's a process in doing that. That process is surrendering to Jesus, seeking, praying to the Father, asking God who the Son is. You get a revelation, and it says those who are believe and are baptized shall be saved. That's what the Apostle Peter said in the book of Acts chapter 3. Those who believe and are baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ shall be saved. But it must be a conscious decision that you make. You know, the Catholic Church, they still baptize infants. It's got to be a conscious decision you make to follow Jesus. Never mind if you've been baptized as a baby, that doesn't count. You need to be baptized again. You need to make a decision that you want to follow Jesus and that you accept Him as your Lord and Savior. Because believe me, all the Christians that have became Christians wish they had done it a long time ago. Wish they had done it years ago. I did it when I was still a teenager. So I've been a Christian over 20 years. And I don't regret it one bit. Absolutely don't regret it. Love being a Christian. Allowing God to pour His Spirit out on me. I don't deserve salvation, but God does that. Because I've obeyed the gospel. You repent, you accept Jesus, be baptized. Have water baptism, spirit baptism. Hallelujah. I don't regret making that decision to do it. When I make a decision, I follow through with it. And it should be like that with all of us. Don't decide to become a Christian or decide to do something and do it half-heartedly. Do it all the way. If you decide to follow Jesus, do it all the way. Because Jesus said He doesn't like lukewarm people. He doesn't like the lukewarm. He says He'll spew them out of His mouth. He doesn't like lukewarmness. He says you're either going to be cold or you're going to be hot towards Him, towards Jesus Christ. And at one point I was as far away from God as you can imagine. Filled with darkness, filled with rebellion, filled with alcohol, drugs, doing my own thing. Just a spirit of darkness I had. And then when I seen the light of the gospel, it just blinded me spiritually. I knew I needed Jesus. You know, and it's just pray for clarity in your life. Nice if you've got a religion, it's not going to save you. It says only faith in God, faith in what Jesus did for you, will save your soul. Those who believe and repent shall be saved. Take God on His word. Take God on His word. There's physical death and there's spiritual death. A lot of people are spiritually dead. Their conscience has been seared. And they basically do what they want. They go out, do what they want, say what they want. Lie to their partners. Have multiple girlfriends, multiple boyfriends. The days that we're living in is really wicked. You know what I mean? But God asks for honesty. If you're honest with Him, He knows where you've fallen short. And all we need to do is ask for forgiveness. Tell Him. Admit that you've fallen short. Ask Him for forgiveness. And He'll forgive you. It says in the Epistle of John, that when you repent of your sin to the High Priest in Heaven, who's called Jesus Christ, He's faithful to forgive you. It's not a priest that you go to, according to the Bible. According to the Bible, the High Priest is Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
think about it seriously. You know, all religions that are out there require some kind of blood. Some kind of blood to be shed. Every single religion out there, think about it. Consider that. Consider if it's possible that Jesus died for your sin. And if it's possible, think about the love that was involved in that, the obedience that was involved in that, to redeem your soul from death and from hell, spiritually speaking, to give you new life in the spirit and in the body and in the mind. Because most of our minds are in the gutter these days. Sometimes my mind's in the gutter as well, and I need to pray. I need to ask for forgiveness. We're all living in the same world, and it's the same temptations we go through, whether it be money, sensual temptation, power, whatever it may be. We're all under, it's a test to see if you're going to put God first. And those that do put God first, they have great testimonies. I've met people who've given up $100,000 or $500,000 a year job just to follow Jesus, just to preach the gospel. Because basically the wisdom in that is you could inherit everything in this world. Imagine that tomorrow you woke up and you were the king of the entire world. You had all the money in the world, all the servants, everything you wanted. But you're still going to have to die physically, and you're still going to have to face God and still going to be judged by God. So the wisdom in following Jesus Christ is that when a man is born again, they're dead to the flesh life. That means they're dead to the world. That doesn't mean that they're unaware of what's happening in the world. It just means that God has shut that door to what the devil is doing in the world. Okay? And you need to shut that door on Satan. And you need to make a decision to follow Jesus Christ. Because Jesus is real, God is real. Believe me, heard so many heaven and hell testimonies. You know, you just go on YouTube and you just type in heaven and hell testimonies, there's thousands of them. I had one myself, in a way, before I was saved. I was in darkness, I was shown that I was just in complete darkness spiritually. And that my soul would just be going down. I knew that it would be going to hell when I died. And when I heard the gospel and I saw that light and Jesus came into my life through His Spirit, when I truly repented and asked Jesus in, it's a real life and a light that comes into you from heaven. That's how nobody can tell me that I'm born again or not. I hear Christians making a decision for God and they say, well, I didn't feel any different. Well, my question is, have you been sincere with God? Have you truly cried and mourned about your sin before God? How wicked the things that you've done. Have you truly mourned your sin? Jesus said, blessed are those who mourn. I just lost my uncle yesterday. Well, the other week it was at a funeral. And you know, you see the family mourning because their papa's gone, their papa's dead. You know, but the Bible says every man dies and faces the judgment. You know, he was quite a righteous man. I don't know if he went to heaven. He was a Christian. But I don't know if he knew Jesus, if he was born again. Jesus said a man must be born again to enter into the kingdom of God. If you've not experienced the Holy Spirit in your life, you're more than likely going to hell. That's, you know, it's a real fact. It's a fact. It's just a fact that we all have to face. Some of us try to follow different religions, but none of them guarantee heaven. And a lot of religions, they talk about an afterlife, and they talk about a judgment, and they talk about a heaven and a hell. None of them guarantee salvation. Even if you live your best life now, as one of these false prophets, Joel Osteen, talks about your best life now, if you're truly following Jesus, it's a challenge. You're going to go through a lot of trials. You're not going to drive around in Ferraris. Okay? Let Jesus Christ be your covering. Let Jesus Christ in. I won't tell you what my ex-boss said, but you got to try it and see. That's what, didn't say quite that, but you got to try something to find out if it's real. You know what I mean? But you got to be sincere before God. And God knows our hearts. Hallelujah. You've not had an experience with the Holy Spirit. You've not really sought the things of God before. Please consider. Please consider them now. None of us are guaranteed of tomorrow. I could walk out there and get knocked down. At least I'll have a confidence, at least I'll have a confidence that I'm going to go to heaven be with Jesus, you know. And so we must live our life like that every day. You can't please God without faith. We must make sure that we're allowing God to refine us, because we can always be more righteous, you know, like Jesus went out and healed people every day. Sometimes we've been able to pray for people and they've gotten healed, but Jesus Christ is the standard, you know. Think about that. A lot of us say we're Christians, but why aren't you then going and healing the sick, going into hospital, praying for people coming out of wheelchairs? I've seen it happen, but I mean, just think of that. There's always a higher level of righteousness and to be more refined in the Holy Spirit. I don't know if many of you are Christians. Some of you say you are Christians. Some of you have an understanding that Jesus didn't die on a cross. But I would challenge you today. Now, as Martin Luther, is it 500 years ago? Martin Luther said, well, this Catholicism is not... He started reading the Bible and he discovered that the Catholicism wasn't biblical. I mean, Jesus never commanded his disciples to wear a dress and sit in little cubicles and forgive people of their sin. That's not what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches, preach the gospel, what Jesus did on the cross. He is the King and High Priest in heaven. Only through him you can be saved and be forgiven. Mary knows that herself. Mary had to be born again as well, as all Jesus' brothers as well. James, the brother of Jesus, and all the rest of the brothers and sisters that Jesus had, according to the Bible, according to the Word of God, Jesus had other brothers and sisters. According to Catholicism, Jesus didn't have any brothers and sisters. According to the Bible, he did. He was the firstborn of Mary. Mary was a young woman, a young teenage girl, and the Holy Spirit overshadowed her. And according to prophecy, the Holy Spirit went in there and put Jesus into our womb miraculously, and that is our Lord and Savior. When I was in Israel, I saw the hill of Gilgal, which is shaped like a skull, and there's a big mosque there just outside where Jesus was crucified. But if you go into it, it's like the Garden Tomb, and if you go in there, there's like Christians that run that place, and it's really great. But to see that with your own eyes, to go into the very tomb that Jesus was in, and then came out 3 days later, and I saw a group of Christians from Brazil, and they all went into the tomb and came out speaking in tongues. That's a spiritual gift according to the Bible, 1 Corinthians 12. It says that when you get born again, there's 9 spiritual gifts. And according to the book of Isaiah, book of Revelation, there's the dimensions of the spirits of God. Spirit of understanding, spirit of might, spirit of knowledge, the spirit of the fear of the Lord. So these are speaking of the kingdom of heaven, that when a man is born again, you experience heaven through God's Spirit. And that's how the prophets, they dreamed dreams and saw visions, according to Joel the prophet. And he saw that in the last days, that God's Spirit, or Yahweh's Spirit, would be poured out upon all nations. All flesh, in other words, Africans, Europeans, Americans, and then the people would begin to dream dreams and see visions. And what are these dreams about? A lot of them are about God's judgment. A lot of them are about events which are happening or going to happen. The Bible itself in Daniel 11 talks about three world wars. Many Christians have seen is a guy called Henry Grover, who's seen a lot of prophecy himself throughout a long time. And so, are you part of Jesus Christ's body on earth? It says in the last days there'll be a bride. In other words, there'll be a called out church or a body of people who've been born again, who are seeking after the kingdom of God. As Jesus said, give to Caesar what is Caesar's, and give to God what is God's. You know, the people that are worldly are always just after money and power, position. But your very life, your very soul belongs to God. Are you ready to lay it down at that altar, that Jesus laid his life down for you and bled and died for your sin. Are you ready to give God your life and walk according to the Father's will? Jesus says in the last days that many shall come to him, Lord, Lord, and he shall say to them, depart from me, you workers of iniquity, I never knew you. So these are Christians that are calling Jesus Lord. I mean, only a Christian calls Jesus Lord. Lord, Lord, look at all the miracles that I did. You know, look at all the people that I healed. And Jesus comes around and says, I didn't know you, because they didn't fully surrender their life to him.